Hi, this is Jeff Heaton. Welcome to Applications of Deep Neural Networks with Washington University. This video, we're going to try something different. I'm going to let you see a presentation from one of my students. We're going to have a series of videos on these, probably three in all, where I show you some of the Kaggle competition entries that my students did for accounting application that I gave them. So it's common in computer vision to count things in an image. In this competition, what they were tasked to do was count the paper clips in an image. Now, this is very applicable to the real world. They could be counting cars or houses or something from a satellite image or other things. I want to show you these three presentations because they really use some advanced techniques as far as computer vision and show you kind of how you would break down something for a Kaggle competition. Now, the group that I am showing you first is Team PGYNB. That was the name that the students chose for it. The speaker will be Peter Lee, who is one of my students in my class. He's a analytics major in the business school. And his team members are Yuki Oh and Ernst Go. So they are going to demonstrate how to get a fairly accurate ResNet going where they're able to use multiple ResNets ensembled together, but they do a piecewise ensemble using a quartile score. So it's a very good technique, and I was very interested in this particular technique. This is part of why I chose them to give the presentation. In the overall Kaggle competition, which had over 80 students, they were in position 5, but they used some of the most advanced technology, so that's why I'm very interested in showing you this team's presentation and introducing Peter Lee, who will give the presentation. I'll join in to ask him some questions as we reach the end of his presentation. To see all my videos about Kaggle, neural networks, and other AI topics, click the subscribe button and the bell next to it and select all to be notified of every new video.
Okay, so we're team 5, and we ranked our 5th in the Kaggle competition. The Kaggle competition for the private leaderboard, we are at 0.68, and in public, we're at 0.73. So basically, our private leaderboard has a 0.05 decrease in loss, and I believe that has something to do with our group's overfitting mitigation practice. So to start with, I'd like to talk about our picture pre-process. As you can see right here on the left is the original picture, which actually have 4 channel in the end, which is RGB and A, which is alpha, which is a special channel for PNG files. This is not pretty important because the RGB is the important here. And it took around 92 kilobytes. We subtract this image with the base image, leads to the second image right here, which as you can see, all these lines are already gone, although these parts are still also being deleted as well. But most of the red lines and blue lines are gone. And this is a grayscale image, which means that it is only has 256 by 256 by 1 here, and it only has a 26 kilobyte of size. It is also pretty important because later on when we use the model, the trainable parameters would be significantly lower, which would decrease our training time. Here's the code for the picture pre-process on the left here. Here is TQDM. TQDM is a very useful thing to estimate. Oh, by the way, my code is also posted on Kaggle Notebook, so if you want to check it out, you can. The TQDM is a pretty useful for estimating loop time. As you can see, it's a pretty good-looking progress bar, which tells you remaining time and time elapsed. Also tells you how many iterations would it take for 1 second. So as you can see, it's like 2.27 iterations, which means that for 1 second, I can process two images. And it took, for 5,000 image, it took about 36 minutes, which is pretty good, actually. So for all the images, like 5 by 50,000. It took about maybe 3 to 6 hours, which is a pretty good one. We also had a depreciated a picture pre-process function, as you can see right here. As you can see right here, this is much better than the previous one. If you want to compare, I believe this is also presented by one of my group member. However, you can see right here for only 11,000 images, the estimated time is around 18 hours, and it took like 6 seconds for each iteration. So for each image, it takes like 6 seconds to process. So it is too long for us. We don't have that much time to process this image. Although it's pretty good looking, the effect might be as actually seems to be better. We did not use this function. After that, we pre-process data frame. Actually, it's a feature engineering. So we can see right here, these are black pixels. So they are 0, 0. Actually, there's only one dimension, so it's 0. And for these white pixels, it's around 80 or so, or 160. So in an array like this, it's like this. And we can calculate the average pixel number. And for this picture, it's 14.83. The most important thing is that not only it is available for trained data set, it is also available for test data sets. So this is a good feature and engineering process, in my opinion. By calculating the average pixel of each by calculating average pixel of each picture, we can have this left side is the trained data frame, and the right side is test data frame. Each one has an average pixel count. Okay, so here's the important part for our model. We use a quantized separation. So basically, we find out the 33% point of the average pixel, as well as the 66% point of the average pixel. The calculation result is actually 7 and 14. So basically, we separate the trained data set based on the 33% cutoff point of the test data set. And we also do the same for the test data set later. As you can see right here, for trained data set that is lower, has a lower average pixel count of 7.384, it has this much, which is not a very pretty number. And if we use 80% of them as training data and 20% of them as validation data, here's the distribution. The same is for the second data set. Second training data set is like this, and the third training data set is like this. For each data set, we will train on a separate ResNet model, ResNet V2 model, which means that there are three predicting models, and each model will use on its own test data set count. As you can see, since we cut up based on the average pixel of the test data set for three is evenly distributed, except for this one, because the 100 cannot be divided by 333 or something like that. So it's a little bit, it's like 50 more, but that's not a big, huge issue. And we combine these two, three, excuse me, combine the three test data sets prediction into the full prediction. And here's the code for data set cutting, as well as the calculation of the 33 and 66. Here's the ResNet model. So we use the ResNet V2. There's nothing special. You can find out the actual code from the class. I think it's class 6.2. It's pretty much the same model, same code, except for the fact that for the output layer, we're using DANSE 1 instead of the sigmoid with DANSE 10, which because it's a regression model. We do one of the disappointing thing is that in the end, we didn't add any fully connected layer before or after the flatten. Although for a ResNet layer, although for ResNet model, the Microsoft team was designed to have as last fully connected layer as possible. But since we're doing a regression, maybe adding some fully connected layer after the flattened layer would perform better. And here's the point why the grayscale input is important. So as you can see, if we build based on RGB input, the current color parameter would be 3, and the trainable parameter would be 855,000. However, if we're using grayscale input, it's only like 310,000. So it's like 63 less parameters, which would take much less time to train. And for training, here's our code for training. For each quantile, the code would be pretty similar. We read using the train image data generator and use flow from data frame. The color mode is grayscale, and that's pretty much it. The train data generator and test data generator is separately defined, as you can see right here. The interesting part is that the step can be non-integer, which means that as mentioned here before, because the count is not that looking good. So maybe you think like if we divided it by 32, the batch size is actually 32. If we divided it by 32, it might not be integer, which is fine because the decimal models will be, for example, let's say the batch size is 32, the last batch has only six pictures. And if it's non-integer, if you divide it like this, the last six picture will be the last batch. And then the second, from the second epoch, the picture would be, the first batch will start from the beginning of the picture, so of the database. So that's fine. Also, because the compiler here, optimizer equals to Adam, learning rate equals to LR schedule zero, which is also from the original code, the normal model loading method won't work for customized optimizer. It will tell you that the optimizer state cannot be loaded. So, which is a pretty huge, it's not a pretty huge issue, but that's a problem. And our method to mitigate this problem actually doesn't work after I later find out. For model checkpointing, we actually have two model checkpointing. The first model checkpoint is to save the best model. And the second model checkpoint is to save the latest model. Because if we want to resume training, we can load the model from the latest model and resume training by changing the initial epoch right here. For example, if the training ends at like, because it has like 200 epoch, that's the standard epoch number for ResNet. If we train to like 126, we can, you know, resume from 126 using this model and set the initial epoch to 126, and they will resume training. And here comes the problem of the GPU lottery. So if we are assigned with a P100, which is pretty lucky for us, we would be able to train this model in 10 hours, which is pretty good actually. However, if it's KA, P4, or T4, it will take more than 12 hours, which means that we will be forcibly disconnected. So this is very important for us, the resuming training code. So the second point is that the initial epoch of each Colab instance is very slow, thanks to the Google Drive's slow I/O speed, which I will discuss later. So the first epoch where the GPU need to load in the mod into VRAM is extremely slow. The very first epoch will take, no matter what kind of GPU, would take 2 hours to 3 hours. And for the subsequent epochs, it will take around 60 seconds for P100 or up to 125 seconds for K80. And for resume training, the load model won't work because this is a customized optimizer. They think the load model doesn't know what LR schedule is when loading model. However, the code block I posted on the notebook or WeVap used actually failed to resume the optimizer status as well. So the only way I know how to do, at least for now, is to just say optimizer equals the Adam, because here LR schedule equals to zero, the learning rate is 1E-3, which is the default setting of Adam. So this is useless, at least for our circumstances. There's a parameter called custom objects for load models saying that it's an optional dictionary mapping name to custom classes functions, but we failed to figure out how to actually use this parameter. So we use other methods which doesn't work at all. So after delivering the project and reviewing our code, we found out that our code doesn't actually work. So just use load model and it will tell you that the optimizer state is not saved. The issue is that even you use the optimizer equals to Adam and you load model, the LR reduce on plateau status will not resume. This is completely gone. It's unsalvageable. So the best way is to just train within one instance. If you have to train separately with two instances, it will not affect much, but just let you know that the reducer status is no longer retrievable. For prediction, we use this quantile prediction function here, and for each quantile, we predict based on separate models, as you can see right here. According to one, overall, this quantile prediction is pretty similar to the previous one, except for the fact that there's no class mode, which is none, and no shuffle. And we use batch size equals 1, which means that for each picture, we predict individually. We tried batch size equals to 32 before, and there's no difference, actually. But for the sake of safety, I used 1 here. There's no horizontal flip and vertical flip right here. For the previous code for training, we actually used horizontal flip and vertical flip for training data. And from our previous results, that was pretty improvement. At least the loss was decreased by 0.2, I think, from initially it's 1.1 to 0.9 or so. So the flipping, horizontal flip and vertical flip for training is pretty important. And it was recommended online that before you use the test generator, you need to reset it first, especially if you you're using, if you are predicting the test data set. The reason is that some people said that after initializing the generator, the starting point is unknown. Sometimes it will be start at the fourth observation, and the output predicting array or list will mismatch. So using reset here is just a failsafe. Then we concatenate the prediction result, as you can see right here. And then in the very last fine tune is that we hard code to check if two pictures are identical, because we knew which picture has no clips in from the train dataset. Remember, this is from the train dataset instead of processed pictures. So this is a RGB picture. This is a RGB picture, so a grayscale picture. And we compare the RGB picture of test dataset with the RGB picture of the train dataset, and to see if every single pixel is basically the same. We believe that's zero clip count. So it took around 3 minutes, and there are 59 pictures in the 5,000 pictures that have zero clip count. How much improvement does it provide? We don't actually know. Maybe it's like only 0.01 or something, but it's always good because we know the true ground truth value for pictures with zero clip count. And finally, I'd like to talk about how to deal with Google Drive. Google Drive give us a very huge problem, especially initially. The pictures were all over the place. Sometimes when we're trying to unzip, it will not go to the folder it was intended to be and just put it in root folder. And there's no mass deletion for Google Drive. So basically, in the end, with so much hassle, I just completely wipe out my Google Drive using the rmrf command from Python. So basically, I wiped out my whole Google Drive, start again for one instance. These are the three methods we deal with the issue with the Google Drive. The first one is for each instance, we will ask the Google Drive to list the directory for the train data, test data, and the processed train images, as well as processed test images, by keep on running until the IO error is gone. We would make sure that the Google Drive will establish enough cache for the folder so that we will have no IO error later on. And also, we always check the unzip integrity, which means that for train data, we want to make sure that all pictures in here is actually there, and there's no additional pictures that is not supposed to be in here. For example, for train data, we were supposed to have only like 30,000 and later. If we have like 2,000, if we have pictures in this category, which means that we have test data pictures in the train data folder, that is also a problem as well. So we check for the file integrity. This kind of lines is also run for processed data as well. And finally, we merge the two train data sets manually on Windows, and then we split it on Windows by train and test, and then rezip it and re-upload it to the Google Drive, because the file IO, I have no trust on Google Drive's file IO anymore, because so I want to make sure that everything is safe and sound. So I download both data sets on my own computer and manually split and merge. Now, with that being said, we only ranked fifth, and I think there's some issues that we have that we could improve on. The first thing is that actually we think about using transfer learning. As you can see in import, we used exception resident VG, but we didn't do that. For one reason is that the transfer learning requires three dimensions RGB, while grayscale is only one. And that time I thought that the transfer learning will not work well on grayscale image, because I was thinking about like they were trained on the colored image, so maybe they will not work well on the grayscale image. We can expand the dimension to three dimension, but RGB would have the exact same value. Also, ResNet take a lot of time, and because we are already training the ResNet, it's kind of like a sunken cost effect, you know, sunken cost fallacy. Like we are so devoted into one method already, and trying other method would diverse our time for training. I mean, we only have three instances for Google Colab where we have three teammates, so the time, this is very consuming. We actually tried a lot of methods to improve the ResNet model. So we didn't only train one instance. We actually start with no split, and then two split, four split, three split based on the train data set, split based on the test data set. So there's a lot of fine tuning in the ResNet model. And since it's pretty time consuming, we don't really have much time and let's say bother to try a method time Also, just a little thing is like during one of the lecture, professor said that the transfer learning might not help much at this competition because the original model was trained on something that is not might not have such a resemblance of this competition. So at that time, I think, all right, maybe transfer learning is not the way to go. So if we have the chance to do transfer learning, what we can improve? Well, as you can see right here for QRS, we have so many models right here. VGG 19 and 16 is a pretty outdated. It's not pretty outdated, but basically ResNet is the state of the art right now. There's so many ResNet models right here, ResNet V2, ResNet Original, as well as Inception ResNet V2. So with all these models, we can train one model for each quantile. We can train all these models, like all of them for each quantile, and then use ensemble techniques to do the final prediction. Also, we can do KFOS, but KFOS is more computationally intensive. It's like 15 models because for each quantile you have fivefold. I mean, fivefold is the basic more or less. So for each quantile there are five. That's 15 models for one transfer learning. So the KFOS might not be possible, but the ensembles is definitely possible. And here's our presentation. Any questions?
Thank you. That is very, very, very good. Very good presentation. Let's see, are there any questions from the class? An option that happens in real Kaggle competitions is teams will sometimes merge together. I really liked your quantile approach. And I think just looking at the code, I think it would have been very interesting to see to see what would happen if, say, you merged your technique with that quantile separation with one of the other teams that was maybe right at your right in the same ranking or a little higher. It'd be very interesting to see what the two techniques would do together. And it's very interesting in real Kaggles because it's kind of complicated. Because in a real Kaggle, when two teams decide to come together, it's almost like negotiating a treaty between two warring nations, because you can't give your secrets away, but yet you've got to see if your approach would help others. And there's a whole technique to doing that. But I would say I think I didn't see this used in any of the other teams, and I think that's a great way to separate them.
So basically, this was inspired by one of your saying that the picture with many clip counts is a different problem
yes.
than the one which has less. So I think that might be an improvement. It did, which did tremendously. Originally, without any splits, the loss would be 1.1, which is very, very high compared with the leaderboard here. 1.1 is a pretty high value, which is around 10 or so.
Right.
And by splitting it in two, which is small and large, it's jumped to 0.9 and 0.89. However, more splitting is sometimes problematic because we have more arbitrary cutoff points. Because average pixels is a predictor, but it's not a definite cutoff point for predictor. So if you have more artificial cutoff points, for example, if you split based on four data sets, then you have three regression discontinuity, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
And for each model, there are like 4 to 5 extreme values with respect to each model, because some model only can see so many data. So with too many cutoff points, too many quantiles, the form actually get worse. This is what I've received when I do in 4 data sets. However, it seems like 3 data sets, 3 cutoff, the 33% cutoff points seem to be an ideal situation.
So how did you pull it together into your full prediction? Was that an average or something more complicated?
Oh, it's not an average because for this prediction.
Oh, I see. So piecewise.
Yes, piecewise. So basically, okay. For this model, it is only trained on 0.33%, and it's only trained and we test
got it.
Or predict on the 0.3%.
Okay, perfect.
What is the param for average pixel? This is the param for average pixel. Basically, we loading the model into the array and we just NP minus. So what is the average number? Like, for example, this is black because I've pre-processed it to subtract it. So the black is zero. And for these white, maybe it's 83, 92, maybe. So basically the NP means is talking about the density of the picture. Like how many white, what's the density of the white pixels or yeah, something like that.
Okay, good. And that was the question that was asked from one of the students, the average, but you described that well on that. Also, you mentioned the custom objects parameter. I have not used that one myself. So I definitely plan to take a look at that one and see what issues await in terms of using it. Are there any other questions from the class? Thank you for watching this video. This was an advanced technique showing how to ensemble multiple ResNets together. I will probably be demonstrating two other student submissions to this semester's Kaggle competition.